Hey, brothers and sisters. I just wanted to go through some of the wacky things that the Lord's been showing me, how they're all interconnected. And it's just, I used to make all these more wild videos all about, the Lord was showing me all about the Ognaten and all that stuff. And as you know, I made the video, I don't even know what all videos I made, and I don't even watch them, you know, but I had a video about the Lord to show me the final road sign before the rapture was the trident. And that was in February 2013. Yeah, the trident and the Florida lease kind of look alike, but it's two different things, because I was asking the Lord about that tonight, and he was showing me they're two different things. And I made all these videos about duality and all this stuff. I can't redo all this stuff in every video, brothers and sisters. It's kind of building on it. You have to go back and look, but I just wanted to talk to you about some things that the Lord's been showing me about the Antichrist, okay, and confirming it. Connected to it as an example, the Florida Lee is one thing, the Florida Lease, or Florida Lee, and one thing, and it's an example. One way the Lord has shown me the Florida Lease was about the D-Malay. I know, if you guys know my testimony, I used to be in the D-Malay when I was a teenager. And then I was in the Masons. My dad was a Mason, and so I joined the Masons as soon as I turned 21. I wanted to do it because I thought it was interesting. My dad was one. And I joined, and then I was never active because I was only 21 years old. There's a bunch of old people in there, you know, a bunch of old guys that are retired, you know, like in the VFW. I'm in the VFW, too, you know. I'm a life member of the VFW because I was in, you know, in Iraq and all that in the war. I was in the war before there, and I was signed up by some old retiree who was one of my patients before I was in a medic in the Army, and he signed me up for the VFW, but I've never been active in that either. But anyway, now, when I became a Christian and became a pastor, the Lord showed me out of the blue that Masonry was evil. I didn't really even know that or think about that, and I didn't really know why, but I destroyed all my stuff, my lambskin apron, they call it, and the books that I had and all that stuff. I destroyed all that stuff and renounced it, repented of it, renounced it, and I've made videos about that in the past. But anyway, so I, you know, it was all part of the journey that the Lord, you know, led me on and knew, or, you know, knew that I was going to do those and then use it for his glory. So I really haven't had time to get into it that much. But anyway, the organization D-Malay is named after the, you know, the last Grand Master of the Knights Templar, and his name was Jacques D-Malay. Okay, so I've been looking at all this different stuff. And as an example, the Lord told me to go back, you know, and just look at it again and just read on Wikipedia and stuff, or the website of the organization. They're talking about Jacques D-Malay. And the Lord had led me look at this. I was like, okay, Lord. And this is out, this is true. And the Lord led me to see this. This is just a little confirmation thing out of the blue. Because, like, I usually just stick with the Bible, of course, but this is all the stuff pointing to the tribulation and what the rise of the kingdom of Antichrist is in the book that I wrote. It's a final boarding call, Satan's plan for the ages. You know, and there's always a disclaimer I have to give, because there's always one, you know, person. I'm looking for the Christ, not the Antichrist. Well, there's people that are not saved that will see this. People that will be left here during the tribulation that will see this by the grace of God and get saved. And not take the mark, okay? So it's not always about you or me, but about anybody and everybody that the Lord would use the video for. Okay. That being said, anyway, Jacques D-Malay, brothers and sisters, was the last Grand Master of the D-Malay, of the Knights Templar. Did you know he was the 23rd Grand Master of the Knights Templar? And what that confirms, brothers and sisters, because the Lord showed me and told me, that's how I know, but 23 is the amount of chromosomes we have. You know, we have two sets of chromosomes that make up our DNA. We get 23 from our dad, 23 from our mom. Now, if you guys have been watching my videos, you will know that I talked about that going into King Solomon's temple, there's two pillars there. Now, you know, Masonry uses King Solomon's temple, and they claim they're the Masons who built King Solomon's temple. That's why they call it Masonry, Free Masonry. They're free. They're not slaves. They're free Masons. You know, Masonry is where you get these guilds and all that stuff come through Masonry. Guilds, like a union, fraternity, all of that stuff, it's all connected. That's where they came out of, these guilds. They were free men. Only in those old days, you know, people that don't know, you know, before America, before the days we live in, only the aristocracies could have a weapon like a sword, and only they could travel freely. That's what they're taking the world back to. That's the thing about it. As they said, people that don't study history are bound to repeat it, you know. And so that's true. So if you want to know what the New World Order is going to be like and know what they're doing, we're taking us back to the feudal times is another way of saying what the New World Order will be like. Preventing people from traveling freely, you know, show me your papers like the Nazis did. So in those old days, in the time of the guilds in the Middle Ages and all that stuff, even in way back, you couldn't just travel. Oh, I'm going to go up here and travel. There were periods of freedom under the Romans or whatever and blah, blah, blah. Let's just talk about the Dark Ages and all that, medieval times. You couldn't just travel from Rome to Paris if you were a commoner, just the fodder and the scum to the foot of the king, you know. But if you were in a guild, you could go through because there was a fraternity. And so you could do these secret handshakes and signs and passwords and all that stuff, and then you could travel freely. So that's why they're Freemasons. Anyway, so Jacques de Molay, as I mentioned, is the 23rd and final Grand Master of the Knights Templar. Now, the Knights Templar, I was talking about on the Temple of King Solomon, at the entrance of the temple, there are two pillars. There's Jacob and Boaz. I've talked about this before. I talked about it on the radio show. But each one of those, counting the globe that's on top, is 23 cubits high, counting the top part of it, which is like a globe. One has got the celestial, which is the stars, as above, and the other one has the earth on it, as below. As above, so below. This is used by in all these mystery religions, Kabbalism, they're trying to turn lead into gold and all that, these alchemy and all this other stuff. Knights Templar, all that stuff. The Knights Templar is connected because, they brought this sacred knowledge of the ancient Egyptians and all that stuff to the Europeans, really, and advanced that, which we get now in modern-day Masonry, the Illuminati, and all that stuff. It's connected back through the Knights Templar. Rosicrucians, after the Knights Templar, then the Rosicrucians, and the modern-day Freemasonry. It's all interconnected. But anyway, I'm trying to see. I could run in 100 different directions with this because I'm thinking about the blood moons. I was looking at that today, and someone had sent me a video link of a guy, and he was talking about something that I've mentioned some before, 1492. As I mentioned this and people laughed about it, it's true. It's one of my old videos. Christopher Columbus was a secret Jew. Someone wrote on there, a secret Jew. He was. Christopher Columbus was actually Jewish, and he was from Italy, you know, but he sailed, you know, from the king and queen of Spain, but actually he sailed on the Portuguese ships and the flag on the Portuguese ships. And the reason why I found out this information is because the Lord gave me a vision of the end of the movie Apocalypsis. You know, Mel Gibson, and the end of the movie, if you've seen it, when the guy with that panther spirit, you know, because of the power of the panther spirit, he runs to the beach because the people are chasing him to cut out his heart and already kill him, you know, because he was released from the sacrifice. And there was an eclipse that day in history. He goes out there, they run to the beach, and boom, here they see these ships coming. Of course, that wasn't Christopher Columbus that day, but same setup of the same flags. The Lord showed me in a vision those flags and those ships arriving. And the thing about those flags that Christopher Columbus used, but they're using that, but that wasn't the flags that was flown when actually in the real life story of the movie, when there was the eclipse and then the Indians, you know, they came there to Montezuma and all that, they weren't flying that exact flag. But those flags on the sails used in the movie Apocalypsis was the flags that was used by Christopher Columbus. If I make myself straight on all that. Christopher Columbus' father-in-law, even though Christopher Columbus was an undercover Jew, a secret Jew, a false convert, like lots of Jews did to keep from being persecuted by the Inquisition. Christopher Columbus's father-in-law was a big wheel in the Portuguese branch of the Knights Templar. Now, the Knights Templar had already been wiped out with Jacques de Molay and all that, but some countries did not turn in their Knights Templars to the man, to Philip the Fair of France and to the Pope, Clement the Fourth or Fifth, whatever he was. So Portugal was an example. Scotland was another. That's why we got the Da Vinci Code and all that. You're talking about the Sinclairs and all that. Being the Knights Templar, you know, and all that about the Holy Grail. That's all really connected to who's the bloodline of the Antichrist. I've talked about that before. If you want to know who the Antichrist is, follow the Da Vinci Code as one line of clues, not leading to the bloodline of Jesus Christ and Mary Magdalene, which is a lie straight from the pit of hell. There's some people that even told me they claim to be Christians and said, well, you know, Jesus as a rabbi would have been expected to have a wife. So he probably was married and he had children. No, when they told me that, I was, of course, I didn't believe it, but I was like, well, the Bible doesn't say he did or didn't. So, but of course he didn't. But later on, the Holy Spirit spoke to me. Here's a word of wisdom from the Lord. The Lord said, no, because Jesus' bride is the church. Jesus has a bride. It's the church. So therefore, if he was married to a woman, then how could the church be his bride? Of course, he would be an adulterer, you know, if that was the case. And he's not. Of course, the Lord was Jesus Christ was never married. Anyway, brothers and sisters, as I'm bouncing around here, as the Lord would lead me, you know how I am. All my videos, if I did them succinctly and laid out, I can do that if I wrote it down, you know. But to flow by the Spirit of God, you just got to run with it. So Jacques de Molay was the 23rd, as I mentioned. 23 is the amount of chromosomes we had. What does that tell me? It tells me, and it's another thing that the Lord showed me in the writing about the history of Jacques de Molay and the persecution. There was a 7-year period where the Knights Templar were persecuted. You know, they started being persecuted in 1307. It's supposed to be that's where they got the Friday the 13th from. All the Knights Templar were arrested on Friday the 13th, and that's where that tradition comes from, they say. And then in 1314, Jacques de Molay and Guy of Auvergne were burned at the stake for recanting their, you know, torture-produced confessions of being a bunch of sodomites and spitting on the cross and all this kind of stuff, the crucifix. And who knows if that's true or not? I mean, the bad guys in this are, you know, in the Masons and de Molay, in the de Molay group, Jacques de Molay is seen as a hero because he resisted the man, you know, and the man being Philip the Fair of France, trying to get, you know, the money of the Knights Templar. And the Pope, you know, of course, was forced to do it by Philip the Fair of France. And also, you know, they were getting too big for their britches. They had lots of money, lots of power from all their influence during the Crusades and all that. Plus, they had lost Crusade battles, you know, so it was in everybody's interest for them to go away. Now, are they good guys? Were they sodomites? Were they doing all this Baphomet worship and all that? Whether it be true or not, maybe it is. You know, I'm not endorsing them. I mean, maybe they're all bad guys. I mean, really, at that time, none of these people were Christians. I mean, these knights were supposed to be like priests or monks, and they were going around killing people in the name of Jesus, killing all these people. So obviously, you know, they obviously didn't understand the Bible or what it meant to be a Christian, because they were assassins. Jacques de Molay was an assassin. The Lord is just reminding me of that, and I know that. So to him say he was a good guy, he was a killer, just like Philip the Fair of France was a killer. Anybody that stood in his way was enemies. And then the Pope, of course, lots of popes have had lots of people killed who were their enemies too. You know, there's some that were worse than others, some not so bad, whatever. So, you know, as they say, power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely, right? Only the Lord, by his grace, would give us a thorn in the flesh to keep us from becoming absolutely corrupted. You know, as Paul, the Lord, if you read that text about Paul, where he asked the Lord to remove the thorn in the flesh, and the Lord said, my grace is sufficient for thee. If you read the text, you will see that it's because Paul had a lot of power of God in him, more than about anybody. And God wanted to keep him rooted and grounded in love, that he wouldn't become arrogant and get into trouble. So I'm trying to think. I've just about covered all that. Anyway, I want to keep going on this video and talk about the Pharaoh. The Lord has shown me lots. I've done lots of videos about that. And I've even mentioned this before. Pharaoh in his hands holds the crook and flail. And the Lord had showed me that before, and he just reminded me that again. Of course, Jesus will rule them with a rod of iron, and the crook is like a shepherd's rod. So Jesus is a good shepherd, and when he returns, he will rule the world with a rod of iron. And here is Pharaoh as a type of Antichrist, carrying these implements of a shepherd, false shepherd, and ruling the world with a rod of iron, which is the devil's world, kingdom of Antichrist. Now, and the Lord had given me this about duality. This is wild. And I looked it up and found out more details about it. The Lord was showing me that the crowns that the Pharaoh wears, and the Lord has been showing me this over several days, bits and pieces, and I haven't had time to even talk about it or even look at it like I need to. I really study this, but I throw it out there. Some of you guys will look this up and know more about it than me, and that's what I'm putting it out there to you guys, because this is from the Lord. There's a wisdom in the multitude of counsel, and this is for the body, not my own personal gain information, but to share with you guys. All right, the Lord kept showing me that crown that the Pharaoh wears. And I know this from when I was studying a few years ago when the Lord told me to study Akhenaten and all that. There's upper and lower Egypt crowns. There's two crowns. When you see the Pharaoh wearing both, it means he's ruling over upper and lower Egypt. There's time when upper and lower Egypt were split, time when they were under one Pharaoh. And so here's an example. That's why in Isaiah chapter 19, verse 19, and in that text, it talks about how that God would set up a pillar on the border of and the midst thereof of Egypt, unto himself. And there would be Egyptians that would be, worshiping him or whatever. And that's during the millennial reign of Christ. If you read the text, you'll see that it's talking about during the millennial reign of Christ. But anyway, on the border of and in the midst of, in the middle of a country, but yet on the border of a country, how could that be? Well, of course, Egypt has upper and lower Egypt. And right on the border between upper and lower Egypt, so it's in the middle of Egypt as a whole, but on the border of upper and lower Egypt, is the Great Pyramid, the Giza Plateau. So, that's why lots of people point to say that even the Great Pyramid was possibly built, they call it the Pillar of Enoch, built to God to withstand the flood. I mean, that's one ancient story that's been told and is a theory and possibility that it really was originally built for that purpose. We don't know that. No one knows what the pyramid was originally built for. Lots of people think it's an energy source and all this stuff, which it may also have been built by the Nephilim for that purpose. Who knows? There's so many things that are plausible and are ancient stories and myths. There's always some truth in these myths that you hear. Some truth in there somewhere, whether it be metaphoric or literal or mix of both. So we have to take all these things with a grain of salt and weigh them out, pray about it, compare it to the Word of God, of course. Anyway, so the Lord told me, kept having me look at that. What's the deal with those two things? And then the Lord kept, telling me it's like as above, so below. As above, so below. It's connected to duality. Well, when I looked at this up and I found someone who is from the tribe of people that actually, can speak the ancient language, the builders of the temple, of the pyramid spoke. And this guy is an archaeologist today, and raised by the priest of On or whatever, raised by these people. They're all like died out now. He's one of the last people that speak the language. He's an old man now, and he's been in some documentaries on National Geographic or whatever. And he said, and if you look at it, you can see that the inner crown is the thymus gland. And the outer crown is the womb of a woman. When I already looked at it, I looked at the inner crown, and I was thinking it was some kind of a, the Washington Monument or those obelisks, like a, Osiris's phallus, the fallen angel. And then, if you haven't watched my videos, you know what I'm talking about. Then the womb of a woman, but it's the thymus gland. Is what it represents, and then the outer crown, the second one for the other upper or lower Egypt, whatever is which, is for. Well, it's probably Lower Egypt. Now I think I'm about to look it up. That's a theory that just came into my mind. Upper being as above, so below, Lower Egypt would be the womb, the part that represents the womb. But anyway, all that stuff, as above, so below, all the secret and even the Masonic square and compass, all that stuff points to one thing. Fallen angels, believe it or not, the height of all these cults is always about sex and all that stuff. The Washington Monument, there's also a real obelisk that belonged to Caligula at one time. It's, that's there that he had his horse races there, horse track, right where the Vatican is built. Used to be where Caligula, the movie, this porno movie or whatever with, what's his name, Rodney McDowell or whatever his name is, semi-porno movie from the 80s or 70s, whatever it is, Caligula. And he was, he really was an evil, wacky guy, and they killed him. He was a nut. And in real life, and Caligula Caesar, he had that obelisk moved there from ancient Egypt. It's a real one from Heliopolis. Helios is another name for Apollyon, means the sun, whatever. And Heliopolis is actually in Egypt today, where the palace of the president of Egypt is located. Heliopolis is also the place where Akhenaten ruled and reigned in his career, until his religion, which is a type and shadow of the Antichrist, was ended when his son, King Tut, was murdered. You know, the famous King Tut, that is the son of Akhenaten. Anyway, I'm going all over as the Lord is just leading me to jump on all this. You know, I got all this information in there. It's just a matter of synthesizing it together, you know what I'm saying? Connecting the dots. You know, you can have a whole, it's like having 100 pieces of a puzzle and then you're trying to put it together, you know. This is all connected, brothers and sisters, to point to the kingdom of the Antichrist, to point to the enemy's plan, so that those who hear this, who have an ear to hear, this would get people saved, get people to wake up that we're living in the end times. But anyway... So where was I at? Now I was all over the place for one thing. But anyway, the whole meaning of this as above, so below, believe it or not, you know, there's multiple meanings for everything. There's a surface meaning, and then there's meanings at 10 different levels, you know, to the initiate, and then you go higher in these mystery religions or masonry or the mystery religion of the priesthood of the pharaohs, you know, the temple priest and Karnak and the pyramids and all that, whatever. The higher you go, the more you see these different levels and meanings. So the ultimate meaning is really the fallen angels having sex with human women. That's exactly what they're talking about. You know, turning lead into gold, alchemy. It's not really turning lead into gold. That's what they tell the masses. Really, to turn lead into gold is to take something that's weak and all that and turn it into something that's worth a priceless amount. Take the flesh and become a god. That's what it means, turning lead into gold, becoming a god. So how can I become a god? Well, that's what the whole mark of the beast is about. You know, if you take the mark, you'll become as God, just like Satan told Eve in the garden. If you eat the fruit, you'll become like God. So the day that you take that mark, you will get this DNA change. That's going back to the 23. This is just a weird confirmation that the Lord gave me. Like, you know, there's lots of weird people on YouTube. I usually try to stick with the Word of God, but this is a confirmation about the plans of the enemy and what the mark of the beast is going to be about. I've made lots of videos about this. It's just a whole other angle where the Lord has given me confirmation. It will be a change of DNA, just like the Florida Lee, brothers and sisters, even just like the Trident. You got the Florida Lee on one level of the mystery schools of the devil and all of his people. You know, they put symbols out there for you to see and say, A, it means A. Really, to them, it means B and C or whatever. And in this case, the Florida Lee is a DNA, and then the introduction of a different DNA. Either if you become a Christian, you have the introduction of the Holy Spirit in your heart by the Florida Lee. You could say that. Then you could see the Florida Lee as, I'm a human, and I take the mark of the beast, and boom, I have the introduction of Nephilim, you know, fallen angel DNA. You know, I become an adopted son of Satan, literally in the flesh. You know, I just thought about that. When I become a Christian, my spiritual DNA has changed. And when I get my glorified body, I guess my little DNA will change. I'm spiritually born again. But when you take the mark, since Satan operates in the flesh, and the flesh is, you know, the sarx is the Greek word for flesh, S-A-R-X in English writing, sarx. So our flesh is what we war against. So when you take the mark of the beast, you have a flesh change of your DNA. Your flesh changes with the DNA in the natural. Whereas with God, when you get saved, it's spiritual. But, of course, when we are redeemed at the rapture, at the resurrection, then it will also, our flesh will be transformed, will be changed from corruptible to incorruptible. We will go from lead to gold by the power of God through salvation, through the resurrection, through God. These people are going to think they're gold, but they're going to be fool's gold. That's a good one right there. I can make a video about that, just on that topic. See how the Lord, you know, when I start, I just start talking, and the Lord directs me. As the Bible even says, you know, back there, I believe it's in Jeremiah, where it talks about having a mule that won't move. You know, it's better to be a wild ass who the Lord can steer than a stubborn ass that stands still and, you know, can't go anywhere. Or as someone once said, it's easier to steer a moving car than a parked car. So you got to start moving and let the Lord steer you. So in this case, I think I'm a living example of that in almost all of my videos, brothers and sisters. So people take the mark, they're settling for fool's gold because it is not real, it is not eternal, and it will not last. Well, I take that back. It is eternal in the fact that all of us live for eternity. There is no annihilation, as the Jehovah's Witnesses teach, and we will not go to literally, our spirit will not go to sleep. Our flesh goes to sleep when we die. As far as that, the way the Lord sees it, as Jesus himself said, we sleep. Our flesh sleeps, but not our spirit. Our spirit is alive, always, from the time you're created, through the rest of eternity. We are alive. From the moment that we're created, we live forever beyond that. But of course, God is eternal. We're not eternal because we're not from times past, only from when the point we were created, when we were conceived in our mother's womb. Unless you're a test tube baby, because now we do have test tube babies. It's the first one. I remember that, the first test tube baby was in 1980. What's her name, Lucy or something, wasn't she? It was all in the newspaper. Isn't that 1980, 1982, something like that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, now I've gotten off topic. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I think I covered some excellent points that the Lord brought out as I was speaking. And by the grace of God, by the grace of God, if the Lord doesn't return, I should put all this succinctly in a book and line it up better. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I believe that the rapture is very near and it's very at hand. And I feel like, on one way I want to, plan. And I will continue to plan with the orphanage and all that stuff. But on the other hand, brothers and sisters, I truly believe that our redemption draweth nigh. And I mean literally so close. Of course, everybody said, if I knew, I'm sure lots of people say, I wish I knew when it was going to be. I wish I knew it was going to be, if I knew the day it was going to be, of course, we're going to go at it harder. If I knew it was going to be close. I guess the Lord doesn't tell us because people that found out it was 10 years from now, they're going to be chilling out. Of course, I don't want to do that. But I want to finish the race, and I wish I knew where the finish line was so I could have the right pace to cross at the best pace I can cross. But the Lord hasn't given us that. But I do believe it is so near. And just be prepared to meet the Lord. Stay prayed up. Pray always that you be kind of worthy to escape those things coming on the earth. Stand before the Son of Man. Luke chapter, 21:36. Make sure you do that because the Lord commanded us to do that. To watch and pray always. It should be kind of worthy to escape those things, the tribulation period, and stand before the Son of Man. God bless you guys. I love all of you guys. I appreciate all those who watch my videos. I appreciate all those who have comments and love. And I've gotten lots of good ideas and wisdom and advice from lots of you brothers and sisters. I appreciate it. I'm trying to get through these words of wisdom. I keep hitting a wall. At a certain point, I guess I can't do but so many per video. I don't have any time to rest. It's not, not do with you guys. The YouTube ministry is a blessing. All the ministry work I do from the Lord is a blessing. The orphanage and all that stuff too. I'm just doing all I can, brothers and sisters. And I just don't. It seems like I never get a chance to have a day off. And it just never works out that way. When I was in the States, I was able to take a few days off, but I've still had lots of things going on, that planning and going forward with the ministry. So I guess until the rapture happens, I'm just not going to have a day off. And it's up to the Lord. He's the one. And I know that when I get to heaven, I get to rest all I want and have a good time and enjoy it. So just keep making hay while the sun is shining, as they say. Keep pressing forward. Keep running the race toward the higher calling of God, as the Bible says. It's in our lives. And I'm praying for all you guys. I ask you guys to continue to pray for Joshua's ministry. Thank you to the sponsors. The van we got, it's got a warranty on it, and it was it's 2007, and they shipped it here from Korea. So it's had like dirt in the fuel tank, all this kind of stuff. So we're taking it back, and they'll fix one thing and it's another, but it's under warranty. So thank the Lord for that. So everything's being replaced for free. It's just we had to keep going, keep taking it back over there. But thank God. It's just all these little things, Like the thermostat was stuck, and replaced that. All these little things, brothers and sisters. But thank the Lord, of course, it's under warranty. It's included. We don't have to pay for it. So thank the Lord for that. I just ask you to pray that the van will be finished with all this little issues, little things, get it straightened out so they can really keep it going good, get it rolling. Summertime here, so the kids don't go back to school to the end of May. So got time to get it worked out. God bless you guys. Thank you to all the sponsors for Joshua's ministry. Thank you for those who have helped me. I'm traveling to the States. So I'm getting ready to go to the States the end of May. I'll be in the Philadelphia area. If you're still watching this video, I'm already at 30 minutes. I'm going to stop it. I'll be in the Philadelphia area in Memorial Day weekend. Most people are doing something. I'm going to be there for a wedding. And if someone invites me, you know, they want to see me, I'll stay longer. If not, I'm going to get back below the Mason-Dixon line as fast as I can. Sorry to say, you know, I got to stay below the Mason-Dixon line as much as I can. Sorry about that, guys. But anyway, I'm just joking. Now in January, that's probably true, in the wintertime. Anyway, let me know. I'll be in that area anywhere around there. We can get together. God bless you guys. Then I'll be making my schedule for the summer and the fall. If we're still here to see you guys, let's make a schedule. Some people invited me to Oregon. I believe it is. It's Oregon. I know it is. And just let's start making plans. You know, I like to keep it positive. I like to say, you know, have an idea, because I've been doing lots of traveling. It's lots of uncertainty, brothers and sisters. I don't even know where I'm going to live at when I get to the States. So, you know, I know that the rapture soon, but we don't know when. There's lots of uncertainty, and I don't mind that. But it makes me feel better if I got some, at least, you know, something in my mind. Hey, I got this plan to go here and minister to people and visit with people in Oregon in September. So I got something, you know, when I'm getting tired out and weary, I can say, well, you know, we're going to take that trip up there to Oregon, and I'm going to meet so-and-so who I met, you know, I've been talking to on YouTube. They seem like a nice person, and we're going to get to, you know, go see some site. We can see the ocean there or whatever. And, you know, it's just kind of, you know, give you a happy place, as they say, you know. So you got to have a happy place to go to sometimes. It's not always 24 hours a day, every single moment. Oh, don't tell me that you spend 24 hours just thinking about the Lord all the time. I mean, you know, you got to go to the bathroom sometime. You got to sleep sometime, right? And so, you know, there may be some of you guys are very pious, and you need to be to start doing Gregorian chants or something. But, you know, I sometimes we still have to exist in the real world, especially if you have a family and, you know, kids and a wife and things like that, or a husband. You know, we have to deal in the real world. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. And grace to you in Jesus' name.